The title of my message today is When It Looks Like Nothing's Working. Okay? What do you do when it looks like nothing's working? And I want you to just, I want that to sink in a little bit, because how many times have you felt it isn't working? How many times have you maybe come to church and, you know, maybe you've did everything a wife needs to do, or you've done what you can as a husband, but for some reason, nothing seems to work. You have gotten mad, you've yelled, you've screamed, you've prayed, you've come to church, you've done your best to keep the faith, you've sacrificed. Oh, how you sacrifice! But it still doesn't seem to work. How many of you been there? I mean, I know I have. I mean, you know, so what do you do? What do you actually do, or what have you done when it didn't seem to work? Did you get bitter or better? Huh? Did you stay stuck, or did you find a way to move forward? What did you do when it didn't seem to work? Did you hurt from it, or did you learn from it? Did you still smile, or do you frown? What happens? What happens when it doesn't work? What happens to your faith when it doesn't work? I mean, you know, I want you to know, church, that you're in good company when you get a little frustrated and when you get mad. There's been a lot of people that have, you know, hadn't worked for them. And you know, they come to church and they say, oh, just have faith. Just have faith. It's going to get better. But you've come and you've had the best faith you can have. Come on, somebody. You've done a lot of what they told you to do. And for some reason, it just didn't seem to work. When I look at the Word of God and I see multiple people that have been through what we've been through. Come on, somebody. Because I'm included in this message. All right? I've been there as a pastor when I've done everything I know to do and it still doesn't work. And so today, I'm going to go through some things and I'm going to show you in the Word of God what it says. But then I'm going to teach you what it, we had the best teacher to show us, to teach us what to do when it doesn't work. And I want you to, if you got your Bibles today, not if, you should have your Bibles today. I want you to turn to Psalms 42. And I'm going to just read to you verses 1 through 3. This is the psalmist. And the psalmist says, as the deer pants for the water brook, so pants my soul for you, O God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When shall I come and appear before God? My tears have been my food day and night. Have you been there? I said, my tears have been my food day and night. Have you been there, church? While they continually say to me, where is your God? Come on, somebody. Where is your God? Aren't you a member of City on the Hill? Don't you go to that Holy Ghost church? Where is your God? Why are you going through the things that you're going through? Where is your God? Verse 9 and 10, he says, I will say to my God, why have you forgotten me? What is the psalmist saying? He's saying, I've been praying, ain't nothing happening, Lord. And he's telling God, he says, why have you forgotten me? Why have you forgotten me, God? And he says, why do I go mourning because of the oppression of the enemy? You know the enemy's hot on your tail. You know that the things that happen in your life, you know that straight from the devil. Those things that he come and attack you and they come to do things to you and there's opposition every time you try to take two steps forward, you got to take three steps back. You know that's the devil. And this is what the psalmist, he says, why do I go on mourning because of the oppression of my enemy? As with As with the breaking of my bones, my enemies reproach me while they say to me all day long, where is your God? Where is your God? I was trying to minister to one of my family members one time, and you know, I was struggling. You know, we didn't have much. And this family member of mine, he got employed in the dope game. Come on, somebody. And he says, well, look at me, I'm doing well. I got a nice car, I got a nice house, I got this, I got that. And you know, I was a baby Christian, I was just trying to love on him. I just left it alone. How many of you have just left it alone sometimes when you didn't have words to say? But now I see. And now I see. If I could rewind time, how many of you wish you could go back and say some other stuff? Come on, somebody. You know, you wish you could, well, I wish I would have said this. I wish I would have told him that. I wish I would have told him that. But if I would have went back, I would have said, and how long will it last? How long will it last? It wasn't a couple of months after that, the car was repoed. He got locked up, and I went to go visit him. Come on, somebody. You see, so many people opt out. So many people opt out when it gets tough. When they say, it's just not working, I'm just going to go back to doing what I was doing. So many people opted out. How many of you know that disciples, they wanted to opt out and go back fishing after Jesus got crucified? They were doing well for 3.5 years. They were eating high off, they were living high off the hog. You know, Jesus just wanted fish. He just called them out. Throw the net on this side. Now they had to go back to fishing. So many times we want to opt out because maybe we don't see God. We don't hear God. We don't feel God. You know, it's happening for them, but it ain't happening for me. You know, I'm sure the psalmist, I'm sure David asked the same questions. What do you think? You think David asked the same questions when he was on the run from King Saul? King Saul wanted to kill him, all because people started to like him more than they liked him. And so David was on the run. He was from cave to cave to cave. And then and people began to, can you imagine, people came to David and said, hey, didn't they anoint you king when you were little? Remember, you gave us that testimony how you had a plan and a purpose for your life. How the Lord anointed you king. And they start to bring up these things like, you know, didn't you say you're going to be a preacher, Brother Mike? Well, you don't look like you're doing too hot right now. Why are you running? Why are you running from King Saul and stuff? You know, what's up with your life? Where is God? What do you do when it doesn't seem to work? What do you do when it doesn't seem to work? I'm sure when they told David these questions, where is your God? I bet when he got alone with the Lord, he probably asked the same question. Lord, where are you? I mean, I want to know just as much as they want to know. Where you be at? Where are you, Lord? I mean, David was on the run. You know, I started to research in the message. How long he was on the run. Does anybody know how long David was on the run? For 13 years. And what blew my mind is that it's the same amount of time that Joseph took to get to second in command in Egypt. 13 years. It's a special number about 13. 13 years. You know how long it took Lakewood Church to get out of the feed store? 13 years. 13 years. Here was this young man that had a calling on his life, had a purpose on his life. He had everything going for him. He was anointed. The Lord, the prophet, pressed up all of his brothers just to anoint him. And he had a purpose and a calling for his life. He could have gave up. I wonder if you've given up. I wonder if you threw in the towel. I wonder if you opted out. I wonder if you said, you know what, forget it. I'm just going to kill him when I get a chance. David had two chances to kill the king that was after him, that wanted to take his life. He had two chances. I wonder what would have happened if David would have said, just give me the shank. I'm gonna do him in right now. I'm gonna shank him right now. I wonder what would have happened with David. I wonder what you're planning to do that may forfeit your calling and your purpose. I wonder what you're contemplating in your mind to do that you know it's not the right thing to do. But you want to do it just to get even. Come on, somebody. Well, I want you to know that David didn't do that. David didn't do that. You know, and I'm sure that he wanted to after the first time that he let Saul go. He let Saul go and he says, look, why are you trying to kill me? I didn't do nothing wrong to you. I mean, I'm here. I could have killed you if I wanted to, but I didn't. And then Saul says, you know what? You're a better man than I am. Well, guess what? Saul goes back home and then he changes his mind again. He says, let me go kill him again. Let me go after him again. Then David encounters him again. Could you let somebody go twice? Could somebody hurt you twice? Or after the first time, how many of you said, that ain't never going to happen to me again? And I'm going to tell you, church, what I'm talking to today is kind of heavy. It's a little heavy. So you might have to get somebody to help you hold it up. It's heavy. I don't know if you can hold it. It's just kind of, really, at the end of the message, it's going to boil down to a cross. All right? That you need somebody else to help you carry it. Come on, somebody. That's what it boils down to. You know? And so, I'm sure David, in those 13 years, I'm sure he said, it's not working, Lord. Try to be nice. I'm trying to be cool. I'm trying to believe that you called me to be a king. I'm trying, Lord, but it just ain't working. I said, it's just not working. I know, Lord, you called me. You called me to be a pastor, or you called me to be a preacher. I know you've called me to do great things, but it's just not working. You've called me to be this great husband, Lord, but it's hard for me because I never saw a good husband modeled out in front of me. I'm trying to be a good wife. I'm trying to be a good son, a good daughter. I'm trying, but it just ain't working. It just is not working. You know, some of us ask, why is this happening? It ain't working, but why isn't it working? What am I doing wrong? How many of you said, what am I doing wrong? You know, what is it that I'm doing? I mean, you know, these are all relevant questions. I'm sure David asked these questions. I'm sure Job asked these questions. I'm sure Job, when Job was out there and Job was living a good life, he was doing good, and then all of a sudden, boom, his kids get killed. Boom, his livestock gets stolen. Boom, his barns fall. Boom, he's hit with an illness in his body. Everything just happened just like that. And he's like, why? What did I do to deserve this, oh God? Joseph, 13 years, beaten up by his brothers. And let me tell you something. Even the Lord Jesus Christ, when he was on the earth, he shouted to his father, my father, why have you forsaken me? So let me tell you something, church. Jesus came to show us. He came to show us the way. Let me ask you, if you knew why everything was going the way it was going, or why things happened the way they happened, would it make it easier for you to walk the walk? Or if you said, you know what, forget it, I don't even want it anymore, forget it, I'll just leave it behind. If you knew why God was doing what he was doing, if he knew why he was taking you through the detour that he was taking you, would it make it easier for you? We have a good, good Father. It's who he is. I believe that many times folks want to achieve a life of greatness without any sacrifice of self. And that's one of the things that God wants to show us. He wants to show us the sacrifice. You know, in my personal life, I've learned to wait. I've learned to trust. I've learned to examine myself. And this is the big one. And I've learned not to doubt myself. That's the greatest weapon the enemy has for you. Self-doubt. And that every time that something goes wrong in your life, you begin to say, what did I do wrong? Maybe it's because I did this. Maybe it's because I did that. Maybe, you know what? Let me tell you something. God knows what he's doing with you. Amen. God knows what he's doing with you. He's a good, good Father. He's a good, good Father. And I know that every trial and every test that I go through is not because I did something wrong. And you got to see that for yourself. Because so many times we go through life and we go through these trials and we want to bail out. We're like, I just can't do it. I guess I'm just not cut out for this. God has greatness in store for you. He has greatness in store for you. Every person that has greatness in store for them is going to have to go through some trials of sacrifice. Amen? I've learned to keep making sacrifices. I've learned to keep making my sacrifices. But it doesn't seem to work. Why, Pastor? Why doesn't it seem to work? Because of your circumstances? Because of what you see? Because of your situation? Did you forget that all things that God make happen to keep you alive? Did you forget all the things that He pulled you out of? Did you forget when you were a little child? I remember being a little kid. My parents were on welfare. We moved from place to place. And I remember we didn't have nothing to eat. And I remember we were hungry. And I remember as a little kid telling myself, man, when I get older, as long as I have breath in my lungs, I'm going to work. I'm going to do what I got to do to always have my family, a place for my family. I remember telling myself this. But you know, who brought me through those situations? Who preserved me? Who kept me? Who protected me? Who was it? It was God. It was God. It's the same God that protected you and brought you out. Amen? It's the same God. And let me tell you something. If He did it then, He'll do it now. Why do we get, as adults, we get so weary and afraid? God has a great mission and an assignment in store for you. You know, I like watching the movies because they're very action-packed. I like watching the movies Mission Impossible, right? The Mission Impossible, they would find this great, you know, tough guy, which Ethan Hawke, that's the character in there. And this guy has the tools. He has the skills. And every time they get this mission that's impossible, they find Ethan Hawke. They find a way to get to him, and they send him a little telegram. He opens up the telegram. Either he reads it or they show it to him. They say, look, man, this is something that we got to accomplish, and we believe you're the guy to accomplish it. We're the guy that we know that you can do it. And so Ethan Hawke looks at it, and after he looks at it, what do they say at the end? This is your mission, should you choose to accept it. And I begin to think about when God called me. Now, He didn't show me the whole picture of everything that was going to happen. But He did tell me, this is your mission, should you choose to accept it. God doesn't force us. You see, they send that Mission Impossible to Ethan Hawke, but it still was up to him to accept it. And when you accept the calling on your life, if you say, God, I'm willing to go wherever you want me to go. I'm willing to do whatever you want me to do. I'm willing to give up whatever I need to give up to accomplish this mission. Then you just accepted the mission that God had in store for you. Now, when you accept the mission, you get right in the middle of the war zone. You're like, ah! I mean, you're roadkill. I mean, you'd already accepted it. You're in it. You can't just say, ah! Throw the gun and ah! You can't just do that. It's over. All right? You're in it. You already know too much. You've already saw the film. You got top secret. You have been given top secret. And the enemy knows that you know. And he's going to come at you. And he's going to try to kill you because you know too much. You were armed and dangerous. You have weapons of mass destruction on your life. And I want you to know, this is your mission, should you choose to accept it. It would be foolish, right, that Ethan Hawke would reject it. Everybody wants to see him take the mission. Why? Because he's the man for the plan. He's the man that can do the job. And let me tell you something. Every mission and every vision that God has given you, you're the man or woman for the job. God called you, He saw you, and He knew that you could accomplish it. If it was too hard for you, if it was too big for you, He would have never came to you. He would have never came to you. But God's a good, good Father. It's who He is. So, going through this, going through these things in life? What do we do when nothing seems to work? Sacrifice. You say, I've been sacrificing, Pastor. I've been sacrificing. Oh, I know you have. I know you have. And so many times people, they look at you, they may talk about you, they may blog about you, they may post about you, they may do all these things about you. Because you know why? Do you know why they do that? Because they don't see no success. There's times in our lives where all we have is sacrifice. That's all we have. That's all we have. Here you have, you know, Abraham, sacrifice. Joseph, for 13 years, all he had was sacrifice. For 13 years, all David had was sacrifice. That's all he had. That's all he had to show up. And so many times people look at you and they say, you're not called to do this. You're not doing this. Because all you have is sacrifice. But God remembers sacrifice. And God honors sacrifice. For 13 years, when that church was up there in the feed store, for 13 years, God saw their sacrifice. You know, this is the thing. You know, it's hard. It's hard sometimes to accept the mission and the assignment. You know, for the grandparent that's there and their children are not living right, and sometimes their children get locked up and they have these grandbabies. That grandmama, that granddaddy could say, you know what? I've already raised my kids. I don't have time for that. But no, they took the mission. They took the assignment. And they said, you know what? I got to do this. For the spouse that's hurt, that maybe their spouse hurt them, but they have a family, you know? And they say, you know, I've been hurt. They did me wrong. But you know what? I'm going to choose to go in it anyway. I'm going to choose to take the sacrifice and stay in this marriage. Sometimes for some people, the sacrifice is just staying in the marriage that they're unhappy in. Or maybe it's your son or your daughter that they don't want to live right. And that you continue to pray and you begin to sacrifice and you get people to tell them, hey, you need to disown them and you just can't do it. It's a sacrifice. It's a sacrifice. And God sees your sacrifice. He knows what you're going through. He knows what you've been through. How about the young girl that grew up in church? The young girl that grew up in church and one day she just rebelled. And then she ended up getting mixed up with the boy. And all of a sudden she came out pregnant. And everybody around her in the world is telling her, you need to abort that baby. But she knows deep down in here, she can't do it. She knows inside that this is your mission should you choose to accept it. And she says, you know what? I'm gonna listen to God. And I don't know how I'm going to do it. But I'm going to go through this. And I'm going to do it. It's impossible. It's hard to the world's eyes. They're, how are you going to do this? How are you going to have this baby? You don't even have a job. You don't have an education. You don't have this. They start telling her all the things that why she can't do it instead of why she can do it. It's a sacrifice, church. What do you do when nothing seems to work? Keep sacrificing. Don't throw in the towel. Don't throw in the towel. For some of the husbands, it's hard for them just to stay in there because your wife keeps talking down to you. She keeps telling you need to get a job. She keeps telling you this. She keeps telling you that. It's a sacrifice to stay in that marriage instead of just taking off and going to the beer joint. Because you know you don't got to pay for no beer once the homeboys are at the beer joint. It's a sacrifice to do what's right. If it gets too bad, just get on the roof. Rather sit on the roof than be in a house with a nagging wife. Come on, somebody. I had a friend of mine that told me that when he got saved and he started reading the Proverbs, and he says, man, there is a scripture in there that talks about going to the roof. And you know what? I used to go to my roof. He says, I would get up on my roof. I had a two-story house, and my wife would be complaining and nagging. I would go get a beer, and I'll get on the roof and drink my beer. It happens, church. It happens. But at least he stayed. At least he stayed. He didn't go very far. I mean, you know. I want you to sacrifice. Let me tell you something, church. You have what it takes. You have what it takes. What do you do when it doesn't work? You sacrifice. It's a sacrifice. That's the key word today. I want you to look. Hebrews 6:10 says that he would not forget your labor of love. He would not forget your labor of love and what you have shown toward his name and what you minister to the saints and do minister. You know? You know, you're waiting on success. A lot of times people in life, they're waiting on success. They're telling God, why isn't this happening? Why isn't that happening? I want this to happen. I want it to manifest. Well, God's saying, I'm waiting on the sacrifice. You're waiting on success. You're hoping it happens. You want one of those quick, get rich quick schemes. I want it to happen. I want success overnight. You're not going to have success without sacrifice. You're not going to have success without sacrifice. And that's why I tell you, even us as a body, as a church, if we can't learn to come together here as a small church, how can we come together as a big church? How can we stand right here and trust God with what we have and what we do and what we say and how we love? How can we trust Him? I read a story once about a young man and his son, and they were there was a wildfire that was, you know, ablazing, and it was catching up to them. The father saw that he couldn't outrun the fire. And so what he did, he stopped. They were in a wagon. He stopped it, and he dug a hole, and then he put a big circle, and he lit it on fire. He lit it on fire, and after he lit it on fire, it dried off, and so him and his son got in there, and the fire was coming. It was coming all around. He said, Dad, we need to get out of here. Dad, we need to leave. He says, no, son, to stand. He says, Dad, but this fire is coming close. He says, listen, I want you to trust me as your father. He says, the fire is all around us, but it can't come near us because this part has already been burned. And he said, trust me. And that's what God wants us to do. You know, he's already paid the price. He's already laid down his life. All he wants us to do is to stand and to trust him and to believe him. And if you stand and trust him and believe him, you'll come through with not even the smell of smoke. Amen? Amen? I want you to get it today, church. We can't continue to ask God for things if we're not willing to go through the suffering or to go through the sacrifice. Amen? Value is determined by your sacrifice. I know one of the students today talked about value. When you honor, you value. Whatever it is that you value, it's going to be sacrificed. I can tell what people value in their lives because they're willing to sacrifice more. And sometimes volunteering or serving is not big on their list, then they'll show up late. Sometimes they won't show up. Sometimes they won't even call. But let the job call. Let the job, well, we need you here on a Saturday. Last minute notice. Oh yeah. What is their sacrifice? Is it for money? But when God calls you to do something, are you that diligent? Are you that faithful? I mean, God sees everything we do, church. God sees everything we do. And this is what I want you to get in your heart, you know? Be faithful at your post. Life is a life of sacrifice, you know? And this is one of the things that I really want you to get, because so many times we think about the Lord and we do these great altar calls. We do these great altar calls to where we say, you know, if you do this, God is going to bless you, and we want the blessing. Or if you apply this is going to work for you. And we go on and go on. And so many times we want favor and we want blessings and we want prosperity and we want all these things. And God is calling us to do that. Everything that He wants to give us, He wants to give it to us freely. But that's not the way God's altar call was. God's altar call was this. He says, anybody that wants to be my disciple must take up his cross and follow me. And follow me. What does the cross represent? What does the cross represent, church? It represents a sacrifice. You can play something, son. It represents a sacrifice. Let me tell you something. This is the way God was showing us. God did not go to the cross as the Lion of the tribe of Judah. God didn't go to the cross as a powerful God. He went as a lamb. He went as a sacrifice, a holy sacrifice that was acceptable for me and for you, so that we can live, so that we can conquer, so that we can have power, so that we can overcome. That's how he did it. He didn't do it like everybody thought he was going to do it. And people are waiting for you to do this miraculous thing. You're waiting for God to just drop down on you with fire and give you this power. But God's saying, sacrifice. Be a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. I know it's not popular. I know it's not popular. And that's why a lot of people don't make greatness. There's only a few that achieve greatness, because the majority of people are not willing to go through the pain. They're not willing to say, Lord, I give it all up. I don't care what happens to me. I'm willing, Lord, to go through this with you, than to try to be on the mountaintop without you. And that's what it takes, church. It takes a sacrifice. And that's what I want to ask you today. Where is your cross? Where is your cross? Now, you may not have a wooden cross, but you have a cross. You have something in your life that that you need to sacrifice. Or there's some things that y'all have already sacrificed. Some things that, like I said before, these are things that you took on and you see no results and you see nothing happening. But I want you to know that God sees your sacrifice. He knows everything that you've gone through. He knows the way you've been treated. He knows that the way that sometimes sacrifices is just staying with people that are loving people even though they don't love you back. Amen. I told you it was going to be heavy, didn't I? I told you it was going to be heavy. I told you that even Jesus, when he got his cross, when he picked up his cross, another brother had to come and help him carry his cross. And so sometimes we need people to come along to help us with our cross. Sometimes we need to go help somebody else with their cross. When they say, you know what? I don't know what I'm going to do. I don't know the hurt that I'm going through is just too much to bear. It's too much to bear. I don't know if I can go through it, but we say, you know, the Lord says to forgive. I know what the Lord says, but I got this burden right now. I got this cross, and I don't know if I can do it. I don't know if I can do it. Let me tell you something about a sacrifice, church. A sacrifice kills your flesh. A sacrifice kills the things that doesn't want to do it. You know, they don't want to go through the pain. They don't want to go through the hurt. But that's the sacrifice. How many of you want to start a business? But there's just too much fear. There's too much hurt. There's too many possibilities that it can go wrong. But there's a possibility that it can go right. But you got to keep sacrificing. I mean, church, there's so many things in our life that the devil holds us back. All because of the things that we think up in our mind. You know, sacrifice has blood. What makes you bleed? Sacrifice has thorns. It pricks you. It sticks you. It hurts. But that's what Jesus, he took the cross, and Jesus says, if you want to be my disciple, he says, pick up your cross. Sacrifice it. Don't continue to live the same old lives year after year after year without doing anything different. I know that giving sometimes hurts. I know when I talk about giving, some people cringe. You know, I know that, you know, maybe forgiving or maybe just holding your tongue for a little bit hurts, because you want to say everything that's on your mind. I want you to carry your sacrifice, church. I want you to carry your cross. You know, sacrifice, it challenges you. A sacrifice challenges you. It makes you go higher. And I want to tell you, you may be going through this for 5, 10, 6, I don't know how many years, but God is faithful and He remembers the sacrifice. There's a scripture in Psalms chapter 20, verse 3. Psalms 20, verse 3, I'm going to read it to you right here, what it says about God. Psalms 20, verse 3, He says, may He remember all your offerings and accept your burnt sacrifice. May He remember all your offerings, every offering you gave, every sacrifice that you did. I know that some we have the same volunteers that come in here day after day, and they've sacrificed. You know, it would be nice for them to have some relief. It would be nice to have them, but you know, that's what it takes. It takes people that are sold out. Amen. There's a lot of dreams and things that you want in your life, and I'm telling you, you can achieve them. You can achieve them, but it's going to take some sacrifice, church. I've learned something in being a pastor that it's so much harder to sacrifice the things that God wants when you build your house before you build God's house. You know, and what I mean by that is that, you know, I think about like Abraham, before he was even rich, he always made an altar. He always built an altar of sacrifice. But when you begin to build your own life and your own empire so high and so big, you're so focused on not losing it. And it's so hard for you to reach over and do something for God because you don't want to leave your comfort. You build a great nest. You build a great house. You live in a comfortable house and you drive in a comfortable car. And all that is fine if you have the house and the house doesn't have you. If you have the car and the car doesn't have you. I see the people that are sold out for God. You know the people that are sold out for God? Are these people that come up and celebrate recovery. That they just got delivered from drugs. They got delivered from the whorehouse. They got delivered. They have nothing. They have nothing. But they're so happy and they're so joyful because God, in His great honor and great mercy, took them out of the situation they were in. And they say, you know, Lord, all that I have belongs to You. All that I have is Yours, Lord. My life, I give it to You as a living sacrifice. I don't have nothing to hold on to. So harder to give up things once they have us. So many times we invite things into our lives and we just think we're just going to have a little bit, but pretty soon they have us. Just like that little affair that you started. You start a little affair and then pretty soon it has you. A little flirting, then it has you. It's the way sin works. But I want to tell you that it's a lot easier to sacrifice to God when you come accustomed to doing it on a daily basis. Every single day is a sacrifice. Every day that you live is a sacrifice. And I want you to know today that God is, He's looking at you and He's saying, I want to make you great. If you saw the greatness that was in store for your life, if you saw what He was trying to bring you through, Joseph had to get ready. He had to get ready to go through the pit. He had to get ready to go through the false accusations of rape in order to become second in command in Egypt. I wonder what God has in store for you. I wonder what God wants to do in your life. I wonder what His calling is for your life. I want to tell you today, church, it takes sacrifice. It's going to be hard to become a living sacrifice. They laugh at you. They gossip at you. Like I said, every time you're looking for success, it's going to take sacrifice. You love and you get nothing back. You work and you get low pay. All you see is people. All the people see is your sacrifice. But I want you to know that God sees it too. And God, I care more about what God thinks than what people think. Amen? I said, I care more about what God thinks than what people think. This morning, I want you to think about that for a moment. I want you to think about right now, I want you to just close your eyes for a moment. And I want you to think about all the times in your life when maybe somebody you love walked out on you, or maybe the plan that you pictured didn't work out the way that it did. Maybe you had a business partner, I don't know. But you begin to murmur and you begin to complain and you begin to get mad at God. God was saying, that wasn't me. My plans for you are good and not evil. And He's telling you right now, don't stop sacrificing. Keep moving forward. I have so much in store for you, my son, my daughter. And if you stop now, you'll regret it for the rest of your life. Continue to walk with Jesus. Continue to come back to Jesus. Jesus is calling you this morning. He's calling you by name. He knows you. He knows everything you've been through. He knows all the stuff that you wanted to quit many times, but you didn't. And so this morning, He's calling you back. And so right now, I'm going to pray for you. And I just want you to stay right there where you are, and I want you to allow the Holy Spirit to talk to you. If you're in this place and you say, you know, I've stopped. I've stopped moving forward, and I just began to stand still. And I know it's because of the things that I've been wanting to see that I haven't seen. But today, I want to apologize to the Lord. I want to ask the Lord to forgive me. And when I want to present myself a living sacrifice again, I want to continue to go forward to what I was doing. And if that's you here today, and that speaks to your heart, and maybe you've been murmuring and complaining, and I want you to know that God forgives you. But today, if that's you, I'm going to give you the opportunity to get right with God. I'm going to give you the opportunity just to present yourself. So if that's you here today, I'm going to count to three again. And if that's you, I want you to just shoot your hand up in the air. Are you ready? I said, are you ready, church? Okay. One. Two. Three. I want you to just keep your hands up for a moment. Just keep your hands up for a moment. And right now, wherever you stand, God sees you, He knows you, and He loves you. And He wants to take you places that you can never even think or imagine. And He wants you to know today, He wants me to tell you, is don't be afraid of the pain. Don't be afraid of the pain. I've took the sting out of death. You have no need to fear. But today, I want you to recommit and rededicate your life to what I've purposed you for. So right now, I want you to repeat after me. If you have your hands up, say, Lord Jesus, today I pick up my cross. I pick up my cross, Lord, and I sacrifice all the things that have tried to keep me from following you and from being faithful to you. And right now, Lord, I ask you to forgive me for not giving a perfect sacrifice to you. You deserve more. You didn't complain about your cross, Lord. So I'm not going to complain about my cross. You suffered. You were beaten. And you died in my place. And so, Lord, I'm not going to do anything less than my best for you. Today, I rededicate and I recommit my life to you. And I give you all the glory, the honor, and the praise in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Come on, church, give them a shout of praise. Give them a shout. Would you stand to your feet with me? Hallelujah. And I want you to know that God loves you. And I know that you know it. But I want you to know that He loves you enough to be honest with you. He loves you enough to bring you through things. He loves you enough to tell you the truth. He loves you enough, church. And I want you to know this morning that as you go through the journeys of life, and there's the valleys, and there's the storms, and there's the deserts, I want you to know that you're going to make it. You're going to make it through. Amen? You're going to make it. I want to tell you that I love you, and I'm very, very proud of every one of you, and especially for those that have made Christ the center of your life and you've recommitted your life. We'll be up here being my wife and some of the leaders, if you need prayer for anything. I also want to invite you out. We're going to be at the park today. We're going to go to Studentwood Park again, and we're just going to be out there fellowshipping and witnessing. So if you want to come out, if you want to bring something, you can sign up with Pastor Jaime and Pastor Cynthia or some of the leaders, and so that way they can put your name down. We're going to just be buying some pizzas and buying a thing of chicken, and we're going to be out there at the park. So if you want to come out, please sign up so we know how many people are coming, and we'll see you guys out there. God bless you this morning. I pray that you were you blessed today? Did you receive the word today? Amen. God bless you.